One of these days the sky's gonna break and everything will escape, and I'll know.
Let's talk about third-party politics for a second. You ran three times. I criticized you once during the Gore election. I think that was in 2000. But you've been a passionate advocate that we need more than these locked-in two parties or both captured, which I agree with you 100%, by the concentration of corporate power in this country. But tell me a scenario in which a third party might work other than a parliamentary system, because it seems to me that if you or Ross Perot or Teddy Roosevelt run on a brand new third party without having that parliamentary system in place, the inevitable result is that you're going to elect the worst of the worst of the worst Republicans, because you're going to split the progressive vote.
Well, first of all, you're right. A parliamentary system is more flexible. The Green Party in Germany, under German law, the moment they got 5% or more of the vote, they got 5% or more of the parliament. And so that allows new agendas that aren't encumbered by commercial supremacists to have a voice. And they had a real, as you know, role in the German Social Democratic Party. And yeah. Germany's way ahead of us now in the way they price renewables compared to the way they price fossils.
Well, you know, Germany has more solar deployed than the whole rest of the world combined.
Yeah.
Because of those changes in the political system.
Yeah, proportional representation. Okay, we don't have that in this country. So back to your question. First of all, I would start the effort.
And incidentally, Ralph, Germany has less sunlight than Alaska.
I know, they can't say it's like, Florida, shall we say. In Florida, the nuclear power industry got through the state legislature a early cost recovery where they're increasing people's electrical bills to pay for future nuclear power plants that haven't been even licensed or publicly heard. You see the tyranny of these corporate supremacists, these corporate dominators, and that's law now in Florida.
That's amazing.
And there's virtually no money behind the small citizen groups. The Ecology Party, for example, is trying to fight this. Well, anyway, back to your question. Well, first of all, I think that we're going to get three-way.
Well, I mean, are you acknowledging we do need a parliamentary system?
I think that not only are we gridlocked in Washington, even when, the Democrats have 60% of the Congress about, but the Senate is another gridlock inside the gridlock. And the Senate is like blocking everything, blocking appointments, blocking the proposed head of OSHA, which is trying to deal with tens of thousands of worker lives lost every year. But we're not going to get it for the time being. But in terms of a third party, fourth party, first of all, we got to recognize constitutionally that everyone should have a right to run, apart from the tactics of the effect of the run. Otherwise, we'll say, running for office is free speech, Bobby, as we all know. It's the ultimate form of free speech because it involves assembly, petition, and speech. And so we can't ever posit a philosophy that says, because one of the parties is worse than the other, even though both of the major parties are no bargain, we've got to continue their race to the bottom. Having said that, if the Greens got, 4, 5, 6 million votes, or another party gets 4, 5, 6 million votes, it becomes a factor after the election that has to be responded to. And unfortunately, the ballot access laws make it very difficult, unless you're a Perot billionaire or a potential Bloomberg billionaire, to get on these ballots and get those kind of votes, because people get very self-corrosively pragmatic. They say, look, we like what Nader says or what Ron Paul says or what these other party people say, but let's be realistic. The system is rigged and only one of the two major parties are going to win. So why don't we start this at the local level where it's much less problematic? Start it at the city and town level with third-party independent candidates, and then at the state level, and then at the national level. Because if we don't do something, we know that most of our agenda, you can develop it in the civic arena, but if it doesn't get transformed into the electoral political arena, it doesn't get into policy. it doesn't get done. I know there are things we can do ourselves in terms of how we consume things, how we recycle things, how we take care of community credit and community energy and so forth. But there comes a time when if we don't take control of that government as a people, the corporations will continue to control it and turn the government against us like they're doing on nuclear power.
What I would argue with you is that changing this country to a parliamentary system, I think there's tremendous advantages to it, and I would love to see our president do the debate day the way that the British Prime Minister does. That's one of the most entertaining things on TV, and it's great. It's real democracy, you know. Yeah. I would say to you that doing that is such a heavy lift because it's the constitutional changes, et cetera. It's our whole system of government. It's things that people consider sacred. That the easier thing to do, more practical and more pragmatic thing to do, and the first thing that we need to do if anything good is going to happen on the environment, on corporate control, on health insurance, on infrastructure, we've got to change our campaign finance system. We got to get rid of the Supreme Court cases that say that, you know, that donations of money is speech. And then we need a real campaign finance system that does what Barry Goldwater said, which is to keep corporate dollars the heck out of the political process.
Yeah, even Barry Goldwater is too radical for a lot of these people in Congress. That whole issue of campaign finance reform is very much in the book. And only the super rich can save us. And people,
I mean, that's really, wouldn't you agree, that's the one reform you need? If you get real campaign finance reform so that corporations aren't controlling our government, but, you know, you actually can revert back to a democracy and get a rational political system again.
It's certainly a big door opener, not just for voters, but for candidates. Public elections should be publicly funded, is the way I put it. But we still have, that's a real door opener, but corporations have other ways to bring government to its knees and the people to its knees. And one is corporate globalization, threatening to, you know, move more industry, more jobs out of the country to communist and fascist dictatorships. So the big struggle in politics has always been in our country between civic democratic values and corporate commercial values. It goes back to the major religions in the world. Every one of them, as far as I could determine, urge their adherents not to give too much power to the merchant class for all the obvious reasons. But, you know, I do believe the people still have the power if they believe it. That's how the Constitution starts, with we the people, not we the corporation. But we've got to turn this demoralization, this feeling of powerlessness, which translates into apathy and inwardness, around. And that's why I did this book, to really, you know, invigorate people with what really is possible on the ground with the kind of technologies and social and other economic solutions that we already have and have been carefully thought out but have been excluded by the corporate state. Never fall.